Yes, thank you very much, Anna. I hope you can see my slides and hear my voice. Yes, thank you. I would like to thank you, Ali, and the KDGO organizer for this invitation, and also David for his wonderful introduction to the precision medicine. And we will go a little bit deeper in the precision by taking a paradigm. And this paradigm is of particular relevance. Yes, okay, perfect. Okay, so in terms of precisions, we will start with a protein that is highly relevant to most of us nephrologists, and this protein is called uromodulin, and the previous name may be more famous in history is tamoxifen protein, discovered in the 1950s. So why is this protein important for us? It's for a very simple reason. It is actually the most important protein you detect in the physiological normal urine. And the second point is this protein is exclusively made by the kidney. Not only it's made by the kidney, but as you can see from this proteomic map of different organs, it is by far, this is a logarithmic scale, the most abundant protein produced by the kidney. So uromodulin is made in the kidney in a very specific location, which is the thick ascending limb of the loop of Henle. And all of us interested in Mendelian disorders, we know that this segment of the kidney tubule is of particular relevance for salt reabsorption, and that mutations in systems operating in this part of the tubule are responsible for Bartter syndrome, the various types of Bartter syndrome. The tubule is also very important for other functions, in particular generating the gradient, allowing us to concentrate the urine. And this is exactly in these tubular cells that uromodulin is produced and secreted through the apical membrane. The protein in itself is very interesting. It is extremely rich in cysteine, and you have actually 48 cysteine residues. You will see that this is important for the genetics. There is also a lot of glycosylation sites, and this is a zona pellucida domain protein, which is usually characteristic for extracellular matrix proteins. And indeed, when uromodulin is cleaved and lost in the urine, it will form this type of filaments, which are here stained by GFP, and these filaments, actually, this matrix is forming the cast, the hyaline cast, and all the casts we have in the urine are made by a matrix of uromodulin, and you can see this network shape is able to trap different types of cells, making the different types of cast we have in the urine. So as I said before, uromodulin is a member of the ZP domain family. So the most famous are the zona pellucida proteins, which are protecting the oocytes. So you will notice that this is kind of conceptually interesting to see that the kidney is producing an extracellular matrix protein abundantly in the urine, and that these proteins usually have a protective role and a trend to make macromolecular complex and filaments. So over the years, the availability of uromodulin knockout mice allow us to better understand the role of this abundant protein, not only in regulating salt transport as expected from its location in the TAL, but also regulating immunity and protecting against kidney stones and urinary tract infections. Inverse correlations were observed, and studies done in the late 80s identify uromodulin as one of the factors protecting against urinary tract infections. We will come back to that at the end of my talk. So uromodulin was of big interest for kidney physiology, but a boost in the literature and in the groups interested was coming from genetic studies. And this is one of the families we identified in Belgium about 20 years ago. And you can see this is a very nice dominant pedigree where individuals reach chronic kidney disease in the adulthood and were also characterized with hyperuricemia. And the disease otherwise was relatively neutral. There was no proteinuria, no hematuria. The kidneys were normal in size. And if you take biopsies, you can see a tremendous tubular interstitial disease with fibrosis. And the group of Tony Blair in Winston-Salem in North Carolina identified the first mutations responsible for this disease, and we came relatively after with several other groups in Europe, and the mutations were found in UMOD, the gene coding for tamoxifen protein or uromodulin. And over the years, these mutations have been accumulating now. There are more than 150. And the mutation landscape over the UMOD gene is very interesting, actually. There is a hotspot in exon 3 and 4. And you can observe that the vast majority, actually more than 99% of the mutations, are missense mutations. And half of these missense are targeting cysteine residues. I told you before that there are 48 cysteine residues in UMOD. And the fact that these cysteines are often targeted by mutations is already telling you something about the nature of the disease, and you could predict that there are folding problems in the mutant protein. And this is indeed what we observed already in Brussels 20 years ago. When you look at this very raw immunostaining for uromodulin in biopsies of the patients with the disease, you can see that you have a gross accumulation of the protein in the tubules instead of being lost in the urine, and you can notice the fibrotic, the fibrosis matrix outside of these damaged tubules. And as predicted by this accumulation, you have much less uromodulin in the urine in the patients that are boring these mutations, and those are early Western blots where you can see the signal is lost and much weaker in individuals with the arrows having mutations compared with patients with kidney disease of other origin. And the group of Tony Blair has shown very nicely using ELISA that actually everyone has a very low level of uromodulin when you harbor a mutation. So it's a biomarker in the negative way. So a loss of urinary excretion is a hallmark of the disease. So we were able, several groups again, to reproduce the disease in mouse using knock-in and other transgenic strategies. And here is an example from my group. You can see that if you have heterozygous or homozygous mutations in uromodulin, this is a human mutation. You have a decrease in the urine and a progressive accumulation of the protein in the kidney. And what you can see here is already very interesting because you can see that the maturation of the core uromodulin is affected, and you observe these aggregates. And this will be key for the pathophysiology of the disease. And you can see that the aggregates and the mutant uromodulin accumulate in the endoplasmic reticulum, causing this fibrotic reaction. So the mechanism of the disease is relatively simple to understand. This is a dominant disease where you have missense mutations. The missense mutations lead to a trafficking defect. There is a stop of the protein in its secretory pathway, accumulation of mutant proteins interfering probably with the wild type in the endoplasmic reticulum, forming aggregates and ER foldings, and this is causing a typical stress of the endoplasmic reticulum, causing activation of the unfolded protein response pathway and fibrotic changes. So it's a typical gain of toxic function mechanism operating in the kidney. And with the help of KDIGO and other investigators already present today, a few years ago, we proposed to rename this disease, which is relatively of atypical presentation outside of the chronic kidney disease with the dominant mode of inheritance. You have very few symptoms. So we proposed to call this disease ADTKD, autosomal dominant tubulointerstitial kidney disease, with a second part of the name, which is the gene involved. And UMOD is the most frequently observe a gene, but there are other genes involved, in particular MUC1, discovered by the Broad and the Blair group, but also transcription factor and other more rare genes involved. So UMOD and MUC1 together represent the vast majority of ADTKD causal genes. But I will not stop here because it would be too simple. And the Mendelian disorder with this hotspot of mutation and the mechanism of disease is relatively clear. But the interest of UMOD, also to illustrate the previous talk, is coming from another role in more complex disorders, which are hypertension and chronic kidney disease. And the suspicion that UMOD could have such a role came 10 years ago with the first GWAS, and this is the GWAS done by Anna, the first one for the risk of chronic kidney disease. And you can see that the single genome-wide significant locus at the time was UMOD. And this was, again, about 10 years after the discovery of the mutations responsible for the monogenic disease. And over the years, the multiple GWAS have been performed, and they all confirm the unique position of the UMOD locus in the studies. And this is the last GWAS, the million study, in which you can see on the scale the effect size that UMOD is the most the locus with the largest effect size of the more than 300 loci which are now associated with EGFR and CKD in the general population. So this makes a very, very interesting situation. UMOD is not only associated with the risk of CKD, it is also clearly associated with high blood pressure. And this is the first evidence obtained also 10 years ago from an extreme case control design from Iceland, and you can see from Scotland, and you can see here that there was indeed a genome-wide signal over UMOD, and this is kind of expected and interesting considering the role of the gene, as I said to you before, the position of the UMOD also in the thick ascending limb. So UMOD seems to be involved in the risk of chronic kidney disease and in the risk of hypertension at the population level. Of course, when you have a GWAS signal, one of the big challenges is to find the biological rationale for the signal. And for UMOD, the situation was relatively favorable because the top GWAS markers were corresponding to variants which were located in the promoter of the gene in a very strong linkage disequilibrium block. And some of these variants were even interfering with a conserved element responsible for transcriptional control. So that led to the hypothesis that the variants evidenced by GWAS were influencing the transcription of the gene. And that was indeed confirmed by access to human material. You can see on the left that the mRNA level of individuals carrying the risk allele for CKD and hypertension was twofold increased. And this was also observed for the level of uromodulin in the urine. There was a clear effect, which is 1 to 2. So it's a major biological effect, as you can see here. This is a cumulative of many different cohorts. You can see that the risk allele, individuals carrying the risk allele at the homozygous state have a twofold increase in the level of uromodulin in the urine. So these variants actually have a very strong biological effect. They drive the secretion of uromodulin in the urine, but they are associated with a risk for chronic kidney disease and hypertension. So together with Luca Rampoldi in Milan, we modelized this situation in a mouse, and we observe indeed that mice carrying an excess of UMOD, and this is 1 to 2 mimicking the human situation, they are hypertensive, they develop cardiac hypertrophy and a very nice salt responsive hypertension. You can see here standard diet, low sodium diet and standard diet again. The black trace are the transgenic mice harboring double UMOD. And you can see this is really a salt sensitive hypertension. And not only these mice had hypertension, but they also had some discrete signs of kidney damage accumulating over time, like this cast or tubular dilations. And these relatively discrete structural damage in the kidney were confirmed in human cohorts of subjects harboring the same type of modifications you can see here, and the risk genotype. So the UMOD risk genotype, the GWAS risk genotype, is associated with high blood pressure and salt sensitiveness in the mouse, and discrete signs of kidney damage in mouse and humans. The salt sensitivity was also observed in human. I don't have time to elaborate. So there is a clear role of UMOD consistently found in multiple GWAS. But the strange thing is the fact that if you look at the ancestral allele, which is associated with an increased level of uromodulin in the urine, if you look on the global map, you can see that the proportion of the blue ancestral allele driving high UMOD and exposing to the risk is universally high. So the risk allele is common and outside of Africa. And in fact, in Africa and in the equatorial region is a little bit less than elsewhere. So we are in a situation or in which a risk allele seems to be predominant across the globe. And this was very surprising to us because usually genes that are involved in salt handling have a totally different pattern. So please keep this pattern in mind. You see the blue allele is really high everywhere. So this is now a typical pattern for a salt influencing gene, and this is CYP3A5. And you can see there, the ancestral allele is of course very high in Africa, but then it's going down by purifying selection because probably there is an effect on blood pressure which is deleterious in the northern hemisphere. So since UMOD was supposedly having an effect on blood pressure, we were expecting to see something like that, and it's totally different. So what's the reason for that? The reason is the link of uromodulate with infectious disease. And during the past year, we have observed a dramatic situation reminding us about the role of infectious disease in purifying selection. And I just show you now these old studies showing that if you put uromodulin in contact with E. coli in the urine, you have an inhibition of proliferation. And this was supposed to be due to the glycosylation of uromodulin preventing the bacteria to adhere to uroplakin receptors in the urothelial cells, so preventing the urinary tract infections. And urinary tract infections are of major importance nowadays because of the antibiotics and prevention is a little bit less important, but they affect a lot of subjects, particularly women, of course, they recur. And most of the time they involve E. coli, particularly the E. coli type 1, which are the famous UPEC, the uropathogen E. coli. And before the antibiotic era, urinary tract infections were extremely deleterious, associated with high mortality and spontaneous abortion rates. So this was really impacting on fitness. So to try to prove the link between uromodulin and urinary tract infection, we first went to the Human Genome Diversity Project, and you could see there is a correlation between the UMOD ancestral allele and the pathogen diversity in terms of bacteria in 52 different human populations across the globe. And this correlation was observed for bacteria, but not for other pathogens and nor for any other environmental variable. So this was really striking. Then epidemiological studies showed an inverse correlation between uromodulin levels and markers of urinary tract infection. This is a Swiss population in Lausanne. So you can see the negative odds ratio. And this is a US longitudinal study showing that high uromodulin levels are clearly associated with a lower risk of UTI. So we next were able to show recently that the mechanism explaining the protection of uromodulin against UTI is linked to this small protein that you can see here at the top of the type 1 fimbriae of the most aggressive E. coli, responsible for the majority of UTI. And in fact, you know, if you do electron microscopy and structural studies, you can see really that the type 1 fimbriae of E. coli are really interacting with the uromodulin polymeric chains in the urine. And in collaboration with the ETH here in Zurich and the group of Rudy Glockschuber, we could show that uromodulin in the urine is adopting the filaments, the polymeric filaments are adopting this fishbone-like structure where the glycosylated residues are exposed outside of the chain so they can interact with type 1 fimbriae of E. coli. And you have here a magnification of this interaction between the chain, the uromodulin polymers, and the type 1 E. coli. And this is explaining how uromodulin is playing a major role in the clearance of bacteria out of the urinary tract, and also in addition to the prevention of the adhesion of the bacteria to the urothelium. So uromodulin is aggregating the bacteria, promoting their clearance and preventing their interaction with the urinary tract. So you can, of course, understand if you have more of this uromodulin in the urine, you are somehow protected against UTI. And this is a recurrent scheme that genes that protect us in terms of fitness will tend to expand even if there is a cost for that. And the cost for uromodulin is probably a metabolic cost considering the abundance of this protein in the kidney and in the urine. This is a big task for tubular cells to produce this protein again and again. So when we go back to this very famous cartoon by Manolio showing the inverse relationship between rare variant and common variant of different effect size and the postulation by Anna that some very important genes will be involved in this continuum, Uromodulin is clearly one of these genes because we have seen it clearly involved in rare Mendelian disorders, but also a major factor explaining common and more complex disorders, including CKD and hypertension. And more globally, this example is again emphasizing about the role of environment in the genetic architecture of disease. Environment is not only salt and water, like often we believe in the kidney, it's also protection against pathogens. And we have wonderful example in the field of kidney disease with APOL1 and also schistosome and the risk for IgA nephropathy. And uromodulin might be a third example of this very unique and interesting interactions. So I will stop here. I will thank all people involved in these complex studies over the last 20 years, and I would like to thank you very much for your attention.